Hey, welcome, Texas. Welcome, welcome.
I'm going to go ahead and get started because I know we have a lot of information to cover. I'm Amanda Kerman, and I work for the Autism Program of Illinois, and that is who is sponsoring this event tonight. The Autism Program, TAP, is a state-funded grant with 15 network partners who provide autism assessment, treatment, advocacy, consultation, support, and training across the state. Our partners are comprised of 4 universities and 11 service agencies located at 20 sites. The aim of the grant is to educate, serve, and support caregivers, individuals with ASD across the state to ensure access to autism assessment treatment, while also working to educate and support the community and professionals who serve those on the spectrum. We have the map you just saw had all of our sites on it. So we're spread out throughout the state. I'm going to put a link in our chat box for you guys to fill out a survey for us. The more surveys we get completed, the better. So I would appreciate if you would fill that out. It will pop up when you log out of the system tonight after the webinar. And I will go
ahead. All right, thank you.
And hand it off to you all.
Thank you. And I see you're already recording, so thank you for that. Let's see, these recordings will come out afterwards, but you get, frankly, full access. You also have a Q&A at the end, so we're glad that you're here. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We are so excited. This has been a session that has long been coming. I've never seen somebody really break down how do you truly monitor IEP progress? How do you really understand if your child is making progress on their IEP? And how do you understand those charts that you get at your IEP meeting or a couple days beforehand? So we are going to unpack that today with real examples. It's not just going to be talking about it, but we're really going to dive in and look at how do you actually monitor that progress and make sure that your child is tracking where they need to be. So let me do a quick introduction. Although many of you know us by now, my name is Sabrina Shafer. I'm a special education attorney with a fairly extensive background in behavioral analysis. That was a big focus for me for a little over 2 decades. So I'm very excited to be here with you tonight. Part of the gang is Mr. Phil Milsk, the one and only, of course. He actually was a former hearing officer, which is just effectively a special education judge. So he has an enormous wealth of knowledge, and he is going to be on our session in 2 weeks, by the way, where we really break down procedural safeguards, which is that giant packet you get at the end of your IEP meetings. And then, of course, what is life really without Judy Ruffulo? So we have our one and only Judy Ruffulo, special education advocate with us. What's that?
I said, hello, everyone.
she's just done it all. She's a mediator and IEP facilitator. She's been an advocate for 20 plus years, a parent. You know, she's really been through it all. So just an enormous wealth of knowledge, and she's going to help us walk through what she's seeing right now in IEPs, because you've heard us say it before, it's so important that you network and understand what other people are going through to really understand how other people are leveraging their rights. So without further ado, let's get started. Let's talk about how do we really monitor IEP progress. So first and foremost, if you haven't been in the previous sessions of the series, that's okay. I highly recommend you check them out. Go onto the YouTube site, type in Breaking Autism, and you will see all of the different webinars and sessions that we have up there, including this special education advocacy series with TAP. But last week, in the last couple of weeks, we've talked about what fundamentally are your rights right now. From a holistic standpoint, right, looking at the federal government, what they have to say, and then also from a state level. So if you remember nothing else, remember this: school districts still must provide FAPE. If you don't know what that is, check out the last session in the series, or there's some other resources on breakingautism.com. But if you do understand what that means, you understand how powerful that is, that they have to provide a free and appropriate public education. And in that, it's also districts must implement IEPs. So special education rights fundamentally have not changed. There's one minor caveat with waivers for children that are under 3 years old, but we're not going to touch on that. Today is about IEPs. So with that level set, I highly encourage that if you're not sure what your rights are right now, either reach out to us or make sure you understand them, because you cannot empower yourself or your child without knowing what your rights are. I commend you guys for being here. This is huge, huge step. And a lot of parents just don't know what's out there right now. As we talked about last week, right, your child not only just has to make progress, has to have an appropriate education, but they have to make more than just de minimis progress year to year. Otherwise, the court has been very, and this is the Supreme Court, by the way, has been very transparent in that it's effectively not receiving an education at all if a child is just making de minimis, sort of negligible progress year over year. So it's really fundamental. So just some progress is not enough, because I know that'll come up. You'll see, we'll show you how districts kind of tweak the data and manipulate things to not necessarily really represent where your child is at or where they should be. So stay tuned on that. We'll go through that in detail today. So with that, let's talk about some common traps in IEP goal progress reporting.
All right. So these are not in any particular order, okay? But one big one is that the district is not really showing you necessarily where there's a performance gap. The whole purpose of having IEP goals is to measure and monitor the progress. And that's why when we talk about writing IEP goals, we always say, make sure they're measurable, make sure they're measurable. Because this is where, I mean, there's a point in them being measurable, and that is to actually follow them either quarterly or every trimester, whatever your district might use, and actually measure that progress. And you can, you can use that to chart things out. So another trap or, pitfall is not having enough data. If you don't have actual data about how the child is doing on their goals, you can't really determine if they're meeting the goals or not. So that just kind of goes without saying. Another one is not having relevant data. Now, this might seem really innocent, and I think in many cases it truly is, but what I often see on a progress update, and I hope that you all know what I'm talking about when I'm talking about a progress update on an IEP goal. You should be getting these. It's a form. It looks very much like the goal itself. It lists out the goal. It lists out the objective, and it provides actual dated information about where the child is in terms of meeting that goal, or that actually in Illinois, we use objectives, so, or benchmarks, where they are in meeting a particular benchmark on the goal. And that update that comes quarterly should have data. I see all the time, I see making adequate progress, which really doesn't mean anything. Adequate for whom? Adequate for the child? Is that they're making progress, but yeah, it just doesn't give you any information, anything specific about what they're doing or not doing. So you need the data, you need relevant data. And then finally, and I cannot stress this enough, you need to track your child's IEP progress. Yes, the district should do it. Yes, they should, but they are not going to chart it out for you. And they certainly are not going to be advising you point blank when your child doesn't make progress on their goals. So by charting that out, you can actually visually see that performance gap. And so, you know, to expand on that performance gap a little bit, what it really is where your child started and where they should be and where they actually are. Okay, so the difference between where they should be and where they actually are, you know, it could be, I'm going to use my hands, it could be this much, it could be this much, it could be significant. So we're actually going to walk you through a goal so that you can actually see what that looks like. And you can do this with each one of your child's goals. You can keep track of the data. You can chart it if you're, you know, if you're a visual person and that helps. But I'll tell you that charting it really just makes it so clear. And it's so powerful to bring to the team and say, hey, look, you know, this is not true progress, if that is the case. It's also, you know, it's a good feeling for you to say, oh, look, he really did accomplish that goal and look at what he's doing now. So, all right.
That's so true, Judy. I hope if you're taking notes at home, you see what I mean, how awesome she is. I hope you guys caught this. Don't be fooled by the making adequate progress trap. Don't be fooled by that. And so if you're wondering, well, how do I get all this data that I'm supposedly going to be tracking in the next, you know, 45 minutes? You have a right to all of that data, including services logs, all of that. If you need help to understand what kind of rights you have, or even just a letter on how to request that, we have a free letter up on the website. I highly recommend you look and really understand what kind of progress your child is making and look at their entire record when you have time. But to Judy's point, you should be getting a progress update regularly. The other thing I really wanted to, you know, emphasize, because Judy, you just hit on such good points, is the whole purpose of an IEP is to be able to write something that's measurable. So I see this a lot, you know, like in number two, where it says not having enough data. I see this a ton, where maybe you're basing an entire goal off of one data point, or removing services, by the way, off of one data point. They might say, well, he's able to do it in the classroom, but there's nowhere else the child's able to do it. So that's just so important. And if you don't know what to do when you run into these traps, call Judy, reach out to TAP. I'm happy to help. I always say we answer every email we get. I'm happy to help you. These happen constantly, daily for us. So let's talk about the fundamentals of tracking IEP goal progress, because next we're going to go into the real example. And this is where sort of the rubber hits the road. So I really want to make sure that we understand from a high level the fundamentals, and then we're going to dig in. So first and foremost, understand your child's goals. Again, that little nugget that Judy gave us is so powerful when you really let it, you know, sink in and unpack it. The purpose of the IEP is to write truly impactful and measurable, meaningful goals for a child. And if you can't measure it, if you don't understand it, you can't measure it. And if you can't measure it, you have no idea if your child is making progress or not. So really make sure that you understand your child's goals. And if you don't understand something, stop and ask. By the way, you have a right to ask as many questions as you want, any question you want, and to call as many IEP meetings as you want. If someone tells you anything else or otherwise, please know that you have a right to do all of those things. So second, ask for your child's data. As I mentioned, we have a letter that you can use on breakingautism.com. Make sure, if you've been on any of these sessions before, your ask is in writing and you're not talked out of it. The district has to provide you with your child's records. And it's fairly extensive. It includes emails and things like that, often beyond what parents really realize is available to them. And the more insight you can have, you know, the better decisions you can make and a more meaningful participant in your child's education you can be. So it's really, really important. If you need help understanding your child's data, that's another area where you could pull in an advocate for an hour or two just to help you understand things. So third, this is why I, you know, double emphasize what Judy was just saying. Make sure you have enough data, the right data. I know I say this with a behavioral analyst heart, so data is, you know, everything to me, but it's just so true. Make sure you have enough data. If your child's not generalizing something, or you're not seeing it at home or remote learning, whatever it might be, asynchronous learning, make sure that you're writing that down, that becomes part of your child's record. If you're not sure how to make it part of your child's record, we have a video on how to write parental input. Make sure you go to the YouTube channel and watch that. I'll plug it in the chat as well so everyone here has it. Make sure you have enough data. And by the way, your input as a parent and a participant, an equal member of the IEP team, your input is also data. Private professionals, their input is also data. So don't just look at this as, well, the district sent me this. You have so much data that you can use and leverage. So make sure you're looking at that. And last but not least, check present levels. I know we've talked about this in many other sessions, but a present level, so where your child is, sometimes you'll hear it called PLOP, it's called the present levels of performance, is really the foundation of an IEP. You cannot build an IEP without having good, meaningful present levels. If you don't have, if your present levels aren't accurate, you effectively don't have an IEP, unless by chance you just got lucky. If you don't understand the present levels, if they're not comprehensive, if they don't align to the goal, stop the meeting. Do not write your IEP goals without completely accurate present levels. So I know I'm emphasizing this a lot, but I'm telling you, if we get this part right, you're 50% of the way there. So now, what we've all been waiting for, let's dive into a real example.
All right. So I just want to piggyback on something Sabrina said about asking for that data, and that sometimes, you know, don't let them talk you out of it. So frequently what happens is a parent will send an email and say, you know, I'm looking for my goal update report that was due, you know, last October. I haven't seen it. And the next thing that happens is mom's phone rings and it's, hi, Mrs. Ruffulo, is there a problem? You know, no, there's not a problem. I just, you know, I want the information that I need in order to monitor my child's progress. And so, you know, just I always get kind of concerned when a parent makes an innocent request in email and automatically gets that phone call. Like, well, why do you want that? What, you know, it's, you know, it's your right. So I would say, you know, get in the habit of putting everything in writing and then they won't be so surprised. I think, you know, we always say it, if it's not in writing, it didn't happen. Okay. All right. So let's break down a reading goal. So as Sabrina said, again, the present level of performance is crucial. If you don't know what the child can do today, you cannot possibly write a goal with an expectation of what they'll be able to do 1 year from today. That, you know, you need a starting point to figure out an ending point. So in the example that we're going to use, given a fifth grade reading passage, right now, Alex reads an average of 60 words per minute with 8 to 10 errors, okay? That's Alex's present level of academic achievement or present level of performance. You'll hear them called PLOPs, you'll hear them called PLAFs, because they have to use all these acronyms all the time. So, and I always forget in our example here if Alex is a boy or a girl, but neither here nor there. So now that we know where he's at, we can talk about where Alex should be. So 1 year from now, because this is an annual goal, Given fifth grade material, Alex will read 120 words per minute with less than three errors. Okay, so right there, if we compare the two, we're looking at fifth grade reading material. And again, in 1 year, we're looking at fifth grade reading material. That should be a little red flag to you right there, but we're gonna break that down further, okay? So Alex is now reading 60 words a minute. We want him to be reading 120 words per minute. So he's gonna double. He's making a lot of errors. We want him to get down to less than three errors per minute. Now, we're gonna measure the progress at 9 week intervals. So this is a district that's on a quarterly basis. So four times during the school year, okay? That's his goal. So then in Illinois, we use benchmarks for all goals, okay? So the first benchmark, and generally they're broken down by time. They can also be broken down by tasks. But for Alex, so after the first quarter, given fifth grade material, we want him at 70 words a minute with 6 to 8 errors. So we're increasing the reading from 60 to 70, decreasing the errors 8 to 10 to 6 to 8, okay? Next benchmark. So end of the second quarter, after 18 weeks, same thing. We're up to 85 words per minute with 3 to 5 errors. And then 27 weeks, third quarter, up again to 100, less than three, and then 120 with less than three errors. Okay, so I hope that we've made this visual enough for you to see what the progress should be that you're looking for. So when you get that first quarter report, it should very clearly tell you whether Alex is reading at 70 words per minute or whether he's still reading maybe at 62 words per minute. But whatever it is, it should be very evident when you get that report, okay? So now we are going to chart it out for you, and you're going to see something really very revealing and concerning. All right. So what we've got is from our progress reports, first quarter, Alex went up to 62, from 60 to 62, then to 70 to 80 to 92. From the trajectory of that line, it looks like Alex is really making some nice progress in his reading, right? I mean, you can see it right in front of your eyes. But if you look at the very top of the chart where it's 120, and I wish I had a little pointer, but he's really not anywhere near where he's supposed to be at the end of 1 year. There we go. Okay. So now this was his goal. This blue line that you see was the actual goal. So right from the very first quarter, after 9 weeks, he was not making adequate progress. Now he did go from 62 to 70. Is that progress? Yes, it is. Okay. But you can see, if you look at the white space between the red line and the blue line at that very first quarter, you can see that that gap is very small, okay? That's your performance gap. That's where he should be versus where he is. And you can see that actually after 1 year time, Alex is not only still not reading at grade level, he is further behind than he was at the beginning of the year. And I hope that that's really clear to you. Again, you're looking at the space between the red and the blue, and it just keeps getting larger and larger. So by the time Alex is in seventh grade, that gap is even higher. So the goals need to be aggressive, and you need to be able to make sure that what's being measured is what's appropriate for the child. Now, that doesn't mean that you need to go out and learn to become a reading specialist, or, but it does mean that you have to ask those questions, you know, that, well, where does that put him in comparison to same age peers? Do we think that this is something he can attain? Now, just briefly, I'm going to look at the bottom part of the chart where we're talking about the number of errors. Okay. Remember, he started out at 8 to 10 errors. And, you know, does anyone see what's happening here? If you do, type it in the chat real quick. What's happening with his errors? As his reading speed increases, what is happening with Alex's errors? Yeah. Yes, Denise, you win the prize again. Yes, yes, exactly. Okay, so he's making more errors because he's reading faster. Something's not working. Okay. And is he meeting his goal? No, he's not meeting his IEP goal in either of the two areas that we're measuring in, okay? Errors are increasing, speed is increasing, but guess what? When errors increase, comprehension goes down, guys, okay? This goal, this reading goal, doesn't address reading comprehension at all, which is the whole purpose of reading. We read to understand. Otherwise, there's really just no point in it at all. So, you know, and a lot of reading specialists will tell you, and it's very true, fluency is really important. That reading speed is important because as the brain takes in the information, it processes it and it affects that comprehension. So we do want to increase speed, but boy, we sure don't want to increase speed and increase errors. That says to me, there's a decoding problem here, because as he goes faster, he's making more mistakes. He cannot break down the words and decode them. So Alex really needs a decoding goal in addition to all this, but okay. I know that's
a lot. Do you see what I mean? It is a lot, but I want to pause there, Judy, because you said a couple of things that were really, again, profound, and just, I want to make sure, do you see how this is data too, and how you could leverage that data to say, not only is this school not working, so I need different intervention, I need this, this, and that, but also I need a decoding goal. You have data. And when you, if you just chart it, you know, I mean, really this, you know, you just put the different points on the chart, you start to really see, wow, this is not, because here's what I typically see, Judy, I'm sure you do too. I get this report from the district. If they send you anything, if they chart out anything, they're just gonna show you what your kid's actually doing. And then at the IEP meeting, they're gonna say, look, Alex is doing great. Oh my God, look at this giant 62 to 92. Those sound like good numbers. I don't really know what the numbers mean, but those sound good. And they even put, you know, things like WPM, and you're, maybe you know what that means, maybe you don't. And then even look at this, but that doesn't look like a big jump, does it? If you, especially if they took out these numbers, it was just kind of like, oh, maybe it got a little worse. But when you really look at it, you're floored with what, how much this tells you. Not only is this goal not working, my child's falling further behind, and they have other areas of need that are screaming out at us. That's a lot. That's a big difference. That's the difference between your child getting reduced reading intervention or whatever it might be to getting more goals, more services, more support. That's huge.
Exactly.
What were you going to say, Judy? I just wanted to make sure I pointed that out, because that is, so we see this constantly.
I just wanted to say, I mean, I know this is kind of a lot to process at one time, but if you do, you know, you can take a screenshot of this chart, or you can get the presentation, you know, really study this and try, you know, pull one of your goals, your child's goals out of their IEP and try to apply it to your child. And if in your, and it doesn't have to be with a reading goal, it could be with something else, but try to use the same analogy to draw that picture. And if you can't, It's either because your goal isn't measurable or you don't have data. It's one or the
other. Bingo.
So you know what you need to ask for then. You know, hey, I can't really tell if he's really making progress on this goal. Because I think that the progress update reports are the most overlooked documents in the whole IEP process. I ask parents all the time, you know, send me a copy of his IEP and send me his goal updates. And they go, what do you mean? They always have the IEP. They never have the goal updates because either they come maybe attached to the report card or they just don't really understand what they're looking at or what they're looking for. And nobody tells you this stuff. No school is going to draw this out for you and say, hey, look, things are really not going well at all for Alex. It's not going to happen. Okay. You know, it should. I mean, it should be a huge red flag that either that what they're doing isn't working. Maybe he needs a different program or a different intervention, or maybe there's something else going on that, you know, they need to be looking out for. But reading is complicated. There can be lots of different things that can affect it. So
So Judy, I have a question. And you know, and so let's say you have a different goal, right? Because I'm seeing a question here in the chat. You know, how could we make this chart? Where do we make these charts? So let's say this is an executive functioning goal or a math goal. How would you use this exact chart for a different kind of goal? Would these stay the same, the increments?
Yeah, or
the X and Y axis?
In some cases, you know, quarter 1, 2, 3, 4 might be trimester 1, 2, and 3. I usually just use Excel or a spreadsheet program to plot these out. Once you get used to doing this, you don't even really need the visual anymore. It becomes very clear to you. But the nice thing about the visual is actually seeing that performance gap or seeing that performance gap close. That is really exciting. You know, they start using a different reading program with your child or a different math program or, you know, just teaching them in a different way. And all of a sudden that gap starts closing. It's so exciting because that's the purpose. That is the purpose of special education is, you know, to find a way to teach our kids, and they all learn differently.
Yeah. You know, the other question we're getting is, could you also chart the average or where other kids are in the class?
So that is more, you know, that's one of those questions that every parent, I think, if they're totally honest, they sit in an IEP meeting and they wonder, yeah, but where is he compared to the rest of the kids? And some of us will ask that question and you will be told, oh no, we compare Alex to Alex. You know, we don't want to do that. He's his own person and every kid is different, blah, blah, blah. Okay. So I think what you're really looking for in that question is you're looking for normed data, which you could really get almost anywhere. You can even get it on your school report card. If anyone that doesn't know this, every school district and every school within a district gets an annual report card, and this is all laid out in there. This type of data, there's so much data in a school report card, you'll be amazed. If you've never looked at yours, Google it, find it. It should be on your district website, but if it's not, you know, it is maintained by ISBE and you can get that. So anytime you want to know where a national average or a state average, that information is readily available. Now, if you're talking about where is Alex compared to the kids in his classroom, They're not going to give you that. You know, that would be like, you know, that's private information based on specific students. But, you know, that's all data that is normed over great numbers of children. So.
And I would absolutely look at that, because you also, the information that gives you, by the way, that you might not necessarily realize, is how quickly you need to close that gap. Because you're looking at how quickly the kids that you're comparing your child to are learning. And you need to look at where your child is compared to the other kids. You can look at a national average or a state average. You can also get district average in some cases, depending, like, sometimes Ames Web has that kind of information. It just depends, not to get too complicated. But right. Based on the group that you're comparing to, you'll also be able to calculate. Now, this is getting a little bit, this is when you call Judy or you get a little deeper in the weeds, or if you're really advanced and have the time, frankly, for this. You're looking at how quickly those children are learning and how quickly your child will need to learn to catch up to where they should be. So that's a really, really powerful piece of information too, really, because then you can show that.
Such a good point about the time, because some of our kids, you know, if it takes an average typical student, you know, to hear something five times before they learn it and remember it. Some of our kids, it takes 100 times before they hear it and learn it. So our kids do need more time. They need more intensity. They need more. And that's why they have special education.
And that's how you show it. We get parents calling us going, I know my child needs this, but district says they don't. That's what we mean by leverage your data. You have data, it's there. And sometimes it just comes down to time, having time to really plug these things in. That's where somebody like Judy can get this, you know, done for you really quickly. So I know we had a bunch of questions there. I hope that helped. We do have a Q&A at the end so we can answer some more questions, but isn't that so good? I wish we could give this to every single parent. It's like a barrier to entering the special ed world, you know, or you just get it when you find out you're pregnant. You just find out this is it. This is just so incredibly powerful to really understand this kind of information. So, you know, like I said, this presentation will be posted on the YouTube channel, Breaking Autism. You'll see us up there, and this will be posted as well in this other follow-ups and the rest of the series. So in true fun fashion, we're going to do a pop quiz. So we go by the honor system here. If you get the pop quiz correctly, we will help you kind of look at least one of your goals and help you break down what that looks like so you can reach out to us. Denise, you already win one because you're just outstanding. That's why. All right, so pop quiz. I hope you've been paying attention. Let's see. You know we like to trick you guys a little bit. And not take it easy. Don't look at the answer. All right, so your child's IEP calls for 60 minutes a week of OT, occupational therapy. Coming back from winter break, because that's when you always get announcements, right, last minute. Coming back from winter break, your school sends you district's new remote learning plan, which includes a schedule where your child will receive asynchronous OT consisting of videos for you to do with your child. What's wrong? What's wrong with that? Asynchronous is, as it mentions right there, right, where maybe the OT or some professionals or someone at the district has created a couple of videos and you do the work with your child. What's wrong? I'll give you a few minutes to ponder this, see what kind of answers are coming in. What's wrong with this? Parent doesn't have the skill or experience to do OT, not qualified, right? Not getting 60 minutes of OT, professional work. Really good answers.
Yes,
if you recall when we
first love Nicole's answers, not specialized for your child. Yep.
Bingo. So remember, we always talk about, and districts love to make things complicated. We like to keep things simple. your child's IEP is based on the unique needs of your child. That's it. That's it. Doesn't matter what's causing the need. I get that a lot. Well, it's because it's this. It's because of the family. It's because of whatever it might. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what's causing the need. And once your child is identified as a child with special education needs, right? And they have an IEP, that IEP is based on this thing, their unique needs. That's it. And it needs to prepare them for three things: independent living, further education, and employment. So if it falls within one of those buckets, it's got to be covered. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter that the district had a new remote learning plan. Whether that remote learning plan, I've seen this too, by the way, where they send you the general education remote learning plan, and it's not individualized at all. If you don't know what a remote learning plan is, I need to pause. We just did a session last week. Two weeks ago. It's coming out on the YouTube channel. You must watch it. If you do not know what a remote learning plan is, you need to understand your rights between a remote learning plan and an IEP. I'm going to tell you right now in a nutshell, an IEP is legally binding, has federal and state protections, and a remote learning plan does not. You do not need a remote learning plan if you have an IEP, and be careful that you are checking and comparing the two. Be very, very careful, because we're seeing this a lot where districts are taking away a lot, by replacing effectively an IEP with a remote learning plan. And worse, I'm seeing advocates, you know, saying you've got to get a remote learning plan. You know, make sure you fight for a remote learning plan. And I'm going, oh my God, hold the phone. No. So if you don't know about remote learning plans, make sure you check that out. But remember, we talked about it. School districts must provide FAPE and must implement IEPs. That's it. Rights haven't changed. Compare your IEP to the remote learning plan and do not accept in a take it or leave it approach. Your child's IEP is based on their unique needs. So, question number two. All right. Do you want to take this one?
All right. So, no matter how many IEP meetings you have one annual review where they write the new IEP. So you're going into your child's annual reviews. I know somebody here has one tomorrow. Okay, you got your draft copy of the IEP 3 days ahead of time, just like they said they would do and they're required to do now. And then at the IEP meeting, the team starts off and they go right into present levels and go through the goals and all the other parts of the IEP. So what's the problem? Parent had no input. Possibly. Let's just say that, they did. They followed it to the letter. I think this one is really kind of purposefully vague. And so I'm gonna
Daisy, bingo.
Yes.
They didn't discuss, bingo. Good job. Sorry, go ahead, but
excellent.
I love it when
yes.
Bingo.
I missed that in the chat. So yeah. Okay, it's great to start out a new year and new goals and new, everything. And everyone's gung-ho and this is what we're going to work on this year. And gee, it's going to be great. But nobody's talking about whether or not your child met their goals last year. So usually what I see is the closed out goals from the prior year get attached to the new IEP. And you get that to either take home or in this world that we're living in now, you get it emailed to you. And chances are no one ever looks at them again. And you just ended up a whole year without knowing whether or not your child made any progress that year or whether or not they met their goals. And so, one of the things that I wanted to talk about is that, sometimes when they're going through goals, you know, you'll get like a really good feeling and you're like, yeah, he, you know, this is something that he really needs to work on. So I'm really excited that they're going to be focusing on, say, reading comprehension with him, because he can, you know, he seems to be able to read, but he just doesn't seem to really understand it. So this is great. So when you're able to follow along year by year by year, and you know that your child started out not reading and then was able to read and then was able to read more fluently and faster, and but they just weren't comprehending. Okay, now we're looking at maybe there's a, you know, that maybe there's a learning disability there. There's something else going on, a language problem. So the other thing that I hear all the time is that you get this feeling of deja vu when they read a goal. You're like, didn't he have that goal last year? You know, you just have this faint feeling of, I've heard this before, especially with behavior and paying attention and all of those kinds of things. So if you're tracking your child's goals from year to year, and they're repeating goals from year to year, that is the most major red flag that we can tell you about. Your child is not making progress, or they wouldn't be needing to repeat goals. A lot of times what I see too is that when the child moves from elementary to middle school, the middle school team will say, well, we haven't had a chance to work on this with him, so we think it's a good goal and that's what we want to do. That is a big problem, okay?
That's a great example of using one data point. We haven't worked with him yet. Yeah, but we have the neuropsych eval, we have 5 years of data, and we have the reports from the entire team from last year. And we had 3 meetings. We have plenty of data. Let's move on. That's a great example, Judy. I see that constantly. And next thing you know, you've just wasted 3, 4, 5 months of your child's education. And right. There you go. Yeah, that's a great call out. Yep. All right. I'm excited to see how you guys did. Nicely done. Nicely done. I know we've been running out of time and there's been a ton of questions lately. So Judy and I wanted to make sure we have at least a few more minutes for those of you who can't hang on after. Some of you have been amazing about it. So what we want to do now is open it up for Q&A. We have a small enough group. By the way, this will be the portion that will be cut out of the recording when this does get posted. So you're welcome to use your names if you want to or not. It's completely up to you. Real quick, before we open it up for Q&A, I know that there have been a ton of questions. In fact, I have some questions in my email. Don't worry, I saw you, and I'm going to get back to you. But here is our information, our email addresses. Judy's amazing, really amazing at, you know, giving you some time, talking through some questions. I know she can't give you everything, you know, she really wants to, but if you've got questions, make sure you reach out to either one of us. If you're looking for, you know, I saw in the chat, hey, where do we find you? Here's our email, or I'm sorry, here's our website, breakingautism.com. By the way, this applies to every child with an IEP. And there's a lot of information on if you think your child needs an IEP, how do you know? We talk about RTI or MTSS. We talk about 504 plans. So it's really sort of a resource hub for special education rights and advocacy. So check that out. As I mentioned, you just have to type in Breaking Autism into YouTube. You see our channel will pop up, including all these presentations. We're constantly on Twitter and on Facebook. We would love for you to connect with us there as well, and make sure you're sending your questions. And then one last plug for TAP. They're unbelievable. Guys, they put this together. And we've, you know, the more families we can help and get this messaging out there, like I said, I wish you could just attach this on the top of your procedural safeguards or something so you guys have this kind of information. Make sure you fill out that survey. and be very clear about what you want to see next. We're in our planning phase. In fact, we have planning in 2 weeks on what sessions are coming up next. So if you have any ideas at all, I know you're running into a lot of things, go ahead and email us or put it in a survey or go crazy, do them both. But we want to hear from you. It's so important that your needs are met too and that you have the support you need. So make sure you reach out to us. Let us know what you need. We're here for you. So with that, I'm going to open it up. Let's see what kind of questions.
When you're filling out the survey, make sure that you put on the survey, it'll ask you what mark that you're, it's for the TAP Central office and it's a training. And I will let you guys start with the questions. I've got six of them here. Do you want me to read them?
Yeah, sounds great. Let's start with one.
If they aren't giving data or progress, what keywords do I say so the school will respond to the request to get appropriate progress?
So if they're not providing any kind of data at all, they legally have to. Make sure you go to the next session on your procedural safeguards. You know, in the law and in special ed, there's all these acronyms and all these different things, but procedural safeguards are your fundamental rights in special education. And we'll talk about that some more on the next session. But as I mentioned, and I'm gonna pull it up right now, that's why I'm not sharing my screen. We have a letter on breakingautism.com. You can use any of that language. You can tweak it. You can use none of it. But it talks about how to request your records in writing. And it even cites the law if you're in Illinois. So I'm going to put that in the chat. Judy, anything you would add to that?
No. That is good. You're 100% on.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Next question.
How do you get the school staff to acknowledge the data a parent collects to include that info in the present level, especially now with virtual learning?
I'll tell you, sometimes that is hard. That is difficult sometimes. I tend to find the most powerful piece of data is recording a video. And I'll say that because it's also incredibly powerful in front of a hearing officer. You know, if you really see a child who is clearly not learning or paying attention, you know, that's a piece of data that's incredibly powerful. And by the way, I would email that video if you can, because why? You're always creating a record. You're always preparing as if you're going to hearing. And if it's not written down, it didn't happen. So definitely make sure you're writing emails about your concern. If you don't know how to do that, there is an entire webinar. We try to keep them very short so you guys can consume them fast. But there's a webinar on exactly how to write your parental input. Make sure you watch that. I'll put that in the chat too. Because there are certain words that you can use in a format. You want to be very concise and use things like I'm very concerned, not appropriate, regression, what you're actually seeing, but you want to be very concise about that. And that's what we worked through in that one workshop. I'll put that in the chat too, but great question. Judy, anything you'd add there? Oh, you might be on mute, Judy. Can you hear us? Oh, I just saw Judy's note. My apologies. She actually had to step away just for a minute. Okay, so next question. I just put in the chat the request letter. I'm going to send to you as well some of the other resources we're talking about. But the resource page has the workshop, by the way, on how do you request special education and how do you request your record. So I'm going to send that as well and put that in the chat. But yeah, next question.
If we ask for data and they deny it or don't answer or don't respond, do we ask for a PWN?
Prior written notice. I'm assuming that's what you mean, prior written notice. Okay, so if you're getting into those kinds of questions and you even have the acronym, first of all, good for you. Second of all, you have to come to the next session. It's in 2 weeks. It's not this coming Tuesday, but the following Tuesday, because we're going to break this down. You should automatically get your prior written notice. And just for everyone here, there's so much to talk about that. But what that is it's a procedural safeguard, which means it's a way that the law tries to protect you so that you know what's going on with your kid's IEP and your kid's education. There's a lot of fundamental, huge federal rights that you have as a parent with a child with an IEP. That's why we're trying to make sure you get all this information. So you always want to make sure you get prior written notice, because if they don't, that goes back to your ability to have a meaningful participation in your child's IEP. That's that, you know, little blurb I put in the chat. So yes, you want prior written notice, but you also, number one, you want to make sure that you put it in writing, that you're requesting it. Depending on where you are, there are certain rules and regulations on how long the district has to respond to you. It's not like they can't give you the records. You have a right. In Illinois, it's called the Illinois Student Records Act. So you have a right, and there's language in the IDEA as well as in parents' rights. Guys, there's so much to talk about, but fundamentally, no matter where you are, you have rights to these records, and that would be a good example where you might consider filing a state complaint. So that's why we put together that letter, was so that you had a foundation. Send that letter, tweak it so it's in your own language, do whatever you want with it, you know, or run it by an attorney if you're in a different state or an advocate. But make sure you put it in writing, and then they legally have to give you the records. By the way, okay, one other quick note, because I don't know if you guys are going to be on this next session. Make sure you ask to get those records electronically. There's a lot of reasons I don't have time to talk about it. Sometimes they'll try to send you paper. Ask for it electronically. But I'll stop there. There's so much to say. All right, next question.
What the school's reasoning, they don't have reading intervention for middle schoolers and high schoolers? I think that means what is the school's for they don't have reading intervention for middle schools or in high schools. They should have learned the reading skills in elementary is why they won't offer support, even when data shows needs reading intervention. They say they don't have reading material other than the textbooks to read, which prevents the middle school and high school from assessing reading fluency, unlike elementary has those sheets that they test the kids frequently on reading fluency.
Okay.
I'll go after this one.
Oh, go ahead, Judy. Yeah.
There are reading fluency probes all over the internet. They're free. They're easy to get. If they tell you they can't test your child's fluency because of what grade they're in, you know, I don't want to be rude, but they're lying. It's not rocket science by any stretch. You could test your child's reading fluency, okay? And maybe you should. You know, it's not that hard to do. Like I said, the probes are available. You can collect your own data. As far as them refusing to provide intervention, and I can't stress this enough, your child's IEP is about your child's unique needs. If your child can't read in middle school, I would say that's a need. It is such a critical need. They have to provide intervention. They have to provide specialized instruction. If they don't have curriculum, that is not your problem, that is their problem. They have budgets for curriculum. Most of the time they'll borrow it from the grade schools or, you know, I don't know where you're located, but it sounds like a lot of, you need to get really tough with them on this. There's no excuse really for anything, any portion of this question to be happening to any child.
Yeah, great question. That should have been a pop quiz question. It always goes back to the unique needs of your child. That's it. What does your child need? Yeah, great answer. All right, probably we have time for one more question. We'll squeeze it in. I know we always go over, but it's worth it.
When my child's present level reading is 4.3, but he's in grade 8.4, should the goal be set based on his ability or his grade level?
That's an easy, fast answer. A goal should be written for what a child can accomplish in 1 year, or what we would anticipate they could accomplish in 1 year.
Do you want to do another question then?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. What if your child is below the school report card? How do you advocate for your child if they are below the subject area? Would a parent have a case to make?
Again, it would depend on the child's unique situation. If it's a student with an IEP and they have a specific learning disability in a reading math, you know, in one of those areas, maybe we wouldn't expect them to make as much progress as a student who doesn't have that same disability, but the student still has to make progress, and it has to be reasonable. It has to be more than de minimis. The goal should always be, you know, and again, a lot depends on the disability. If we're talking about a child with a cognitive disability, as opposed to a child with just a learning disability in math, the expectations would be different, but the goal should always be to bring them to their highest possible potential. So it's hard to answer how to advocate for that without knowing a whole lot more about the child. I'm trying to do these quick, Sabrina. Let's see, I'm going to go for the shorter one. Can we request the therapy minutes to be weekly teletherapy? Only one out of three school therapists is having weekly 30-minute sessions while remote. Okay, under a remote learning plan, your student should be getting the same number of minutes that's on their IEP. If they're not, you should be tracking that. And when things settle down a little bit, I would, you know, and I wouldn't wait too long. You want to be asking for compensatory time, you know, that my child should have gotten, I don't know, 30 hours of OT in the last 6 months and only got 15. So you owe me 15 hours of OT. When are you going to do it? That's the short answer. If they're trying to substitute asynchronous learning for direct services, no, absolutely not, not acceptable. And you need to put it in writing to the district. Okay, and then the last one. Daughter is failing math, great at math. In the letter, they're saying these issues were with her. Mom wasn't aware of the issues, so couldn't correct it or talk to her. Told the teacher that she should have been notified before she got the letter and the report card. A lot of this depends, again, on the specifics of this child, what their abilities are, and I would say the age of the child. As kids get older, you get less communication from teachers. And certainly as we've gone into remote learning, we're all getting less communication with teachers because teachers are being pulled in so many different directions to serve kids in ways that we were never prepared for, but which doesn't excuse. So if your child has executive functioning issues and you need to stay on them in order for them to maintain their studies or their grades, whatever, you can ask to have that written into the IEP. Or you can work out some kind of communication system with the school. They should not be opposed to that. You know, weekly, every other week, something like that. Okay, we did it.
And we did it. Great question. This is telling me more than ever we probably need another coffee chat or maybe a wine chat. That was fun, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Where we just have an open Q&A and maybe, you know, something that kind of allows everyone to bring their questions. You know, the other thing I would add is if you have any other resources that you need, make sure you reach out to us because it sounds like there's a lot that's already existing. But other than that, thank you everyone for coming and for staying on, for those of you who stayed on late. Make sure you check out that survey. We would love to see your feedback and understand what you want to focus on next. So with that, happy advocating.
Good night, everyone.
Great. Thank you guys so much.
Thanks, bye-bye.